Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rashmi Naiker. I'm the deputy editor with Commercial Design Magazine. It's great to have each and every one of you present here today on this platform. We truly hope this webinar imparts as much knowledge as we seek to share with the industry. We plan to run this as a series on various topics. Now, before we start off with the webinar, just a few things I'd like to confirm. I would first love to confirm if the audio and video is clear at everyone's end. In case there is any issue, absolutely any issue with the audio or the video, please flag us with a remark in the chat session of the webinar screen. For everyone using webinars on the on their laptop, on it would be in the bottom, and everyone using it on your iPhone, your iPad or tablet, it will be on the top right corner. So now, to give you a short and quick introduction about us, the webinar is hosted by Commercial Design Magazine, one of the publications under the ITP Media Group, the company's headquartered out of Dubai. The magazine is one of the titles that aims to loop in various stakeholders in the construction industry, and this ranges across the life cycle of the building, which goes on from the developers, project heads, architects, and facility managers. We realized this cross-pollination between different between every vertical, which usually worked in silos with other publications. We realized this cross-pollination helped us gain a lot of insights into their challenges and the issues. Now, we all know that tech, data, information, and its analysis is what's driving our industry today. And especially for the construction and infrastructure sector, the single most obvious direction, one that helps collate the whole spectrum of information that's required and needed in a presentation, comes together in this one platform that's called BIM. It's mandated across several countries because that's evidently the next step for the industry. But in India, it's clearly still at the earlier stages of implementation and adaptation. And there have been several roadblocks for this, mainly maybe the cost factor, the lack of understanding about the process, the absence of training, to name a few. Now, given this, we decided we'd host this webinar today on the very topic of BIM implementation. The webinar spells out the basics of the process for any organization, right from the best practices and the expertise required for the structure, and to the teams and the workflows, etc. A lot of other topics that speaker would be delving into. Now, we know that the profile of the attendees here range from students and professors to project heads, architects, and owners. We've tried to stage out the session step by step for everyone's understanding, but it's aimed more for the businesses. So in case if you have any questions, please raise them in the Q&A tab in the webinar window. The Q&A tab, again, for the laptop users would be at the bottom, whereas for the iPad and iPhone users or phone users, it would be on the top right corner. Again, I'm just repeating this. Any issue with your audio and video, please flag this at the chat column. And anything for the questions during the session, please raise it only in the Q&A session, Q&A bar, because we might just miss it otherwise. Without much further ado, I'll introduce the speaker, Mr. Kesri Paineni. He is the senior BIM consultant at Voxel One Solutions. Now, through a career that spans over 12 years, Kesri has worked across several cities in the US, APAC, and Middle East. During his 6 years working in Singapore, he also supported the Building Construction Authority, BCA Singapore, to help develop their BIM standards for the sector. He's also published a book titled BIM Specific that delves further into the details of the topic we are discussing here today, BIM implementation. With this, I would request Kesri to take over and initiate the session and take forward the entire webinar from here on. Thank you, Kesri.
Hi. Okay, so sorry about that, I was on mute. Now everybody is able to hear me, I hope.
Yes.
Wish me for the quick introduction. Let me quickly jump into talking about what this session is primarily not. First of all, it's not a quick introduction to building information modeling. It's not the basics of BIM. And also, it is not a standard 3D software demonstration. And it's also not a typical BIM project case study or a success story where you get to see some 3D models. It's more of defining best practices, I would say. What would be ideal for any organization? What are the key items that any company to consider when we talk about implementing them? For the next 30 minutes, I'd like to define BIM more as a building information management and less as a BIM model. I would like everybody to perceive BIM as a process, as a set of workflows that anybody needs to follow using obviously the 3D models. So with that in place, I'm going to spend 5 minutes only to look into the key items of why BIM is important and also the key benefits and all the use cases of it, after which we can get into the actual implementation steps, etc. First one, you know, there is a major difference between a traditional linear process versus the integrated approach towards BIM. It forms a single source of truth for the entire project stakeholders to access information at the right time. And also, it also is a more collaborative approach towards the project design, as well as it improves the overall deliverable quality and provides greater certainty over cost and time. Now, the cost item stands out for everybody, obviously, so I'm just going to quickly, you must have already seen this typical curve where the cost of any design change increases dramatically as we move into the construction in the later phases of the project, whereas the flexibility of making any change also decreases. So in this case, what you're seeing here is BIM allows you to make all the key decisions early in the process where the cost of change is low. Whereas in the typical 2D process, the cost of change is high, which is where most of the issues are identified during the construction stage, and then we send them back to the designers to resolve issues, and there's a huge budget constraint there. So with that, I'm going to quickly talk a little bit about the global level of BIM adoption right now. I would say most of the countries have already, if not made it mandatory, but are already using it to a large extensive manner. Starting with the USA and Canada are already very mature in their implementation. With my personal experience working in Singapore, back in those days, BCA was providing incentives for early adopters, for people to purchase software, for people to purchase hardware. There was a lot of public sector support provided by BCA to the industry to implement them. And of course, there are several other countries. Korea also have their own BIM standards and made it mandatory as well. I'd like to set this perception of BIM more as a lifecycle management tool and not just as a design development and a 3D coordination software-based approach. BIM enables you to access this information and hand over and improve as the project grows. So although the real-time data sharing and integration happens during the construction process, it's more about being able to use this data, the amount of effort that goes into preparing these models for the rest of the life cycle of the project. Talking about digital twins for a more immersive experience for all the operations and the facility management teams. And of course, the 3D enables or expands the possibilities of using latest technology for better experiencing the project, being augmented reality or virtual reality, multiple other new technologies available. Like I said, across the project lifecycle, it is important to know the use case of BIM so that we know how to implement it. Starting from the early planning stage, you get to implement these massing models that can be used for planning and high-level budgeting purposes. and all the way into operation stage where there is a specific asset information incorporated into these models for sorry, I think there is some voice. Rashmi, can you confirm my voice is clear? Okay, voice is clear.
Hello.
Thanks for the confirmation.
Kesri, just a small request. If you could slow down a little, they have been just requesting, the voice is not clear. So if you can just slow down and clear it off. Maybe your movement's also causing the voice alterations, that's why.
All right? Okay, sounds good. So,
okay, over to you.
Back to the BIM users, I was trying to say it is important to know what are the possibilities of using BIM to be able to actually use them, to be able to implement these models, be it at the planning stage, using these massing models for budgeting and scheduling purposes, all the way into construction for coordination, clash detection, quantity takeoff, as well as built modeling. And finally, into the operation space where asset-specific information is also incorporated into these BIM models. So the handover of information, the models growing as it grows, as the project grows into the next phase of the life cycle, that itself causes a lot of concern for implementation. But we are going to look at what type of information that is going into these models clearly, starting from the very early civil site level information, architectural models, structural models, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, every detail item that needs to be built on site is once modeled onto this 3D BIM interface, which results in a more consistent, more high quality 2D documentation for construction teams, and also for better visualization for the owners and design decision makers. And also gives you the quantities that are highly accurate to in sync with the documentation as well. Finally, for helps for scheduling as well as linking the information to the ERP system. Talking about any implementation, of course, it is ideal to take it one step at a time. In this case, we are calling this as BIM maturity levels, which are typically only three. The first one being a traditional 2D workflow where everything is in AutoCAD-based 2D process. But in the level one, if somebody is using 3D models just for the internal design purposes or just for internal design review purposes, that becomes silo BIM, they call it. Whereas BIM for collaboration is where the real use of 3D models start to come out, the real potential start to show. And finally, going into a more integrated approach where all stakeholders are connected to the same 3D model. Now, of course, as you move into one maturity level to the other, the complexity increases, the challenges are also different, the difficulty of implementing these processes also become more complicated. Starting from 3D basic internal teamwork BIM models, I think the only thing that needs to be decided is by the high level management team to say, okay, we need to buy the software and we need to get the team trained so that they can start developing the models. For internal purposes, there is no major challenge. Maybe a challenge would be with templates that they need, etc. Whereas once you go into the collaboration side, there is a lot more questions that needs to be answered. And you need to get the buy-in from several other stakeholders, be it your design consultants or engineers, and as well as from different other stages of the project. Talking about when you start talking to more people, there is also that resistance to change, which is typical to the industry where we are so used to our traditional process. If it is working fine, why do you want to fix it? But in this case, it is more than that. Of course, the standards are many, but there is no single consolidated location for what information to use when. And another question that keeps coming up is, who owns these models? I'm spending extra time for these models. Do I own these models or is it owned by somebody else? Am I getting paid extra for these models? that kind of questions when we talk about BIM for collaboration. But when we talk about the overall integrated BIM workflow, the next level of BIM maturity, it's more about policies, it's more about agreements that are in place, it's more about how the data is being exchanged between the entire life cycle of the project. It's more about what type of cloud technologies do we implement, because there are plenty of those. And are we as an industry prepared for this? And is there any support coming from the public sector or the government to support this initiative? So these are the challenges that come up when we talk about integrated implementation. So now that we know the challenges, now that we know the use cases, let us look at how do we actually go about implementing and using these processes for a better successful BIM project. There are four key points that we always talk about. First one being policies, where BIM standards and manuals are in place. The level of information, the expectations are set right. And the second one being processes, where everything is documented in terms of what needs to happen when. And the third being people, the team that is needed to execute this project, and the kind of training that they need, the skill set that is required for the teams. And finally, to tackle also the technology, because without that, we are not developing 3D models anyways. A bit one level deep into these four key points, policy being developing the right standards for an organization. Typically, when we talk about standards, it is perceived as a project-specific exercise. But in this case, if you are going to use different standards for each project, that is going to result in a more complicated process than having a single approach towards all the types of projects that you're working in. Guidelines and manuals, having a standard set of library, and of course, contracts being in place. I'm going to talk a little bit about contracts later as well. When we talk about processes, it's more about data management processes, as simple as project management processes. How do you collaborate with other consultants? How do you share data? All this needs to be documented. There is a specific slide where I'll go in a little bit more detail about processes also. Leadership buy-in, when we talk about people, BIM implementation should always be a top-down approach. Until and unless the management makes a decision as a strategic approach towards business development, the implementation will not be a real successful next step. Of course, training and knowledge sharing as well. Finally, the technology part, what are the tools that are available? And what is the right software for our BIM use, and what type of cloud implementation is appropriate for the type of projects that I'm working on. These are all the questions that needs to be answered in this stage. Now, when you combine all this into a single package, that makes your BIM roadmap. And of course, that layer of change management is always important to have, so that you have a special way of making sure your teams are following these standards, your projects are following this new approach. Some of the key items to consider when we talk about developing these standards, the three main things that I do want to make sure that everybody is aware of is, like, what is our end goal as an organization? What is our BIM vision? Where do we want to be 2 years down the lane or 5 years down the lane? So that is the first primary point that I request all organizations to first define. And also identify the key performance indicators, like is my goal to improve my efficiency levels by 20%? Define those, or do I improve my quality as a priority? Define how do you measure quality? And make sure you monitor those KPIs, so that you can actually have a case study of how successful you are with your implementation, with the projects that you're implementing. Hello? Looks like there's somebody on the. Okay, let me continue. There was some noise in the background. That's where we are talking about BIM goals. Now, modeling requirements, I always say, unless and until you know why these models are being developed and what is the real life cycle of these models, there is no clarity about what kind of information that needs to go in there. So that is where we talk about the level of detail or level of information and the documents such as BIM execution plan and the quality and quality control and review procedures, etc. All these things are some of the very important items that one needs to consider. So the next few slides are showing you some samples and also are showing you some best practices, as well as trying to explain why doing certain things certain ways is important. Starting with, I always tell my team to start any project with Microsoft Excel and not with a 3D modeling tool, be it Revit or Bentley or any other tool. Because there is a whole lot of preparation that needs to go in the back end before somebody starts a basic 3D model. Especially when we talk about BIM. So some of these are like, one, there's a lot of information that is coming in for a project, be it 2D drawings or is it another 3D model coming from another consultant. Have an information tracker. When are you receiving what? And we spoke about level of detail specifications, how much amount of information that goes into this model, LOI, as well as what exact model elements are going into this. So instead of making a library, project-specific library directly in 3D, I propose my team members always to start with a model element specification. So you already know what kind of library that you need to generate for this particular project. So model element specification is important. Clash reporting matrix, when you talk about coordination, it is impossible to coordinate between multiple disciplines, at least for a large project, without having a proper clash reporting matrix in place. And also the responsibility matrix, who is responsible for what, etc. So back to the main point, don't rush into making models for any project. First start preparing the background work that is needed, start with Excel. And templates, I mean, it is a common practice where people would want to customize the tool to make it look 100% like AutoCAD, because it is always a 2D mindset where we are expecting everything to result in a 2D drawing. I would suggest not to be so picky about making it 100% accurate to the AutoCAD drawing, because it is not a major challenge. And concentrate more on the information that is going into your libraries. Concentrate more on how do you maintain a lighter version of your template. Define your units and share the template with all your stakeholders early in the process. Because if I've seen these cases where sometimes the projects are modeled in millimeters and sometimes a different consultant from a different country has done the model in feet and inches. So that itself causes a huge confusion. That is where templates that are shared across all stakeholders early in the process is very important. And continue to do a thorough quality control and have a process in place to improve your organization level library items for BIM. And there are multiple other online resources for people to download existing libraries. And it's a common practice. You simply download and say, this is a library item I'm going to use for my organization. But you have to have a process to check if it has the right parameters, if it meets your requirements. As basic as, is it in the right units and standards. Contracts, I cannot specify how important this is unless and until we have our own set of BIM contracts in place. There is no real scope of work that we can define for these BIM models, which in turn results in an actual BIM model that is depending on the scope. And there is no way to control the quality. there is no way to allocate the risk to the right resource, and there is no way to define the roles and responsibilities. So having let's not start with AutoCAD drawing converted into a 3D model, but think about how do you maintain the quality, what are you promising to your customer, or what is the employer requirements for this project in BIM. So those needs to be defined. Instead of simply checking a mark saying, okay, this project is BIM, it needs to be dealt with much more detail. Like I said, we have this very common habit of not documenting any process within, at least in our industry, it is hardly documented. Only a bunch of five or six people within an organization really knows what needs to happen next for any project. And when there is somebody leaving the organization, when there's somebody new added into a project, there is a huge confusion where the teams are not aware of what's the status of the project and what are the next steps that needs to happen. So this is where, for a successful implementation, documenting these processes, because these are not traditional 2D processes people are used to do a typical coordination, design coordination review. There needs to be models done by architects, structural and mechanical disciplines. At what frequencies do you do these coordination exercises? So these things need to be documented as a process and shared and agreed by all the project stakeholders. So that makes the entire process more seamless. So BIM execution plan, although it is perceived as a standard document, I've seen a lot of cases where it is developed only for the sake of meeting a specific requirement. Okay, BIM project needs a BVP, but not really use it to its fullest potential. So this is the key part for documenting everything as a project specific guideline for all the stakeholders. So this is not organization specific anymore. It is more about the entire team members accessing information and sharing models. So as simple as the technology or the software that anybody is going to use. For example, there is a possibility where architect starts their model in a specific technology, using a specific software and a specific version, whereas another consultant uses a different software and a different version, and they are not interoperable anymore. So having a BIM execution plan, defining the key milestones, also defining the model breakdown structure, it is very important in this case. Typically, the mindset when we talk about 3D or when we talk about BIM, it is perceived as AutoCAD as several drawings and BIM is a single file. Yeah, conceptually that is true, but of course, BIM requires n number of models for any project to be developed. And how do you break down these models? Needs to be designed early in the process so that all the stakeholders follow the same breakdown. All the way into the contractor level where they're using for fabrication drawings as well, they will further break it down. So there needs to be a process documented for that also. Finally, model review, quality review procedures, meeting schedules, how frequently sharing information happening, etc. So BEP is a very important document. In fact, there is a proposal for a special session talking only about BIM execution plans, which will potentially be a follow-up for this. Now, while BEP is a BIM guideline for project-specific implementation, BIM manual is more about a documentation of everything we just spoke about. All the best practices that you're learning, all the organization-level standards that you're developing, all the goals and objectives, all consolidated into one location, including the software and hardware upgrade plans, etc., results in a well-organized document as a BIM manual, which can be shared with all new team members who are coming into the organization. It's important to have a documentation saying, this is how we do our projects within our organization, and we just follow this. So that guidance is important, especially nowadays where everybody is locked down and working from home. Having a standard operating procedure and being able to share it with all our team members and everybody on the same page will make it very easy for people to collaborate. Now, the responsibilities wise, BIM advisory team is what I wanted to highlight here about, while design consultants and the contractors and the facility management teams are performing their project-specific activities as planned, there needs to be a special team of BIM manager, BIM director, BIM coordinator. Of course, BIM modelers work directly with the consultants and the contractors, but there needs to be a committee who is sharing, who is supporting all these individual teams with right standards, with right templates, with the quality check, with the training needed. So having an in-house BIM committee has its own merits. Of course, without training, implementing new software or new process is definitely impossible. For the simplicity of the implementation, I typically talk about three levels. First being management and the key decision makers needs to get trained in certain aspects of BIM, whereas the follow-up will have different kind of training. Talking about management, a BIM roadmap and what are the benefits of implementing BIM, what are the change management protocols, and how do I plan my next major technology upgrade, and also having a common understanding about the basic BIM contract terminologies. So that is the crux of training needed for any management level teams. Talking about project managers and BIM champions is one important role I would always advise. Identify somebody within your organization who can learn, who can not just use it for a project, but also share that knowledge across all other team members within the organization. So set up a team of BIM champions within your office and look into providing them trainings for how do you implement a specific software, what are the kind of quality control methodologies, and how do you communicate with other stakeholders, including scheduling and planning for the right activities. Finally comes the functional groups, which is pretty common for anybody to go to a training organization and learn a new software and understand the best practices and being able to present a 3D model, etc. But what's missing right now, I feel, within the industry is part one and part two. There is always so much prioritization given to providing training for all the functional groups, but not real training for the project managers and BIM champions, as well as the management and decision makers. Technology matrix, I mean, I have to say this particular list of software or this particular slide in a whole is only made as a way to show that there are many tools that are available that can be used at various levels of the project and for various BIM use cases. This is not in any way trying to recommend any software, but it's more about making a point that you cannot rely on one single software to perform a project, to execute a project. So identifying the right software for the right use case, again going back to the same point, what is the life cycle of my model? That question will answer what software do I need to use and what other relevant interoperability issues I need to look into. So it's all, I always suggest to rely more on process, and because technology is available, it is flexible. If not one software, another software can provide the can provide the specific use case that you are looking for. But as a whole, have a plan in place for you to upgrade your existing technology to the BIM level. Again, talking about technology a little bit more in detail, a common data environment, going from a typical distributed communication process. For example, if I request a drawing for a specific set of information for a project, I might be able to get it from an architect or from an owner or from a structural engineer. So everybody is communicating among themselves in a distributed manner. A bunch of emails are sent out with attachments, or maybe at the max there is an FTP project folder, which eventually becomes being a very massive unorganized set of data. From there, going into a common data environment, which by itself provides a lot of efficiency gain. First being, everybody has access to the latest version of a file. I've seen most of these cases where somebody is looking at version 3 and somebody else is looking at version 4, and there is obvious coordination issue that is happening. So being able to provide the right version to all, latest version to all the stakeholders, and also to enable this process of live model sharing. So there is a clash detection and resolution versus clash avoidance. So while you design the project, while you are making the models, the clashes you can identify because the teams are all using the same set of data. That is where the real value of common data environment shows up. And being able to reuse this information downstream for 4D, 5D, and across all stakeholders. But it's important to have an approach towards how do you, what are you receiving, what are you publishing, and what are you archiving, and what is the process to validate the received information as good to use versus sent back. So these kind of minute details needs to be figured out when you talk about implementing a common data environment for any project. But it is necessary to really gain the value of BIM. CDE, common data environment, is primary approach, the next best thing. Now, hardware, of course, everybody knows all these 3D models require high-end computers to generate right visualizations, etc. But I would say only a bunch of computers or hardware need to be really high-end, the teams who are actually making these models. Apart from that, we already have the technology in place now where you can actually access and review models on your mobiles, models on your iPads or tablet user interfaces. So hardware, you'll have to be very careful when you choose what type of hardware you need for the main design authoring team members. Apart from that, I don't think there is a major challenge in defining any specific hardware. Of course, when we talk about cloud infrastructure, it is important to, since we are going to call that also as hardware, it is important to choose the right vendor to choose the right data storage in-house versus on the cloud, etc. So there was a lot of concern. I mean, India doesn't have its own BIM standards. Everybody has their own set of standards to use. There are concerns like data is not fully mature in India, etc. But I would say it's all about us as an industry, at least to a certain degree, taking the lead in making sure we follow one standard, at least for the organization. I'm not suggesting that we should just take any of these that I'm showing on the screen. All I'm saying is there are multiple standards available for you as a reference. In fact, NASA's BIM execution plan is one of the best BEP I've seen in my career. So I suggest review, search for these standards. You'll be able to easily access them and understand how others are organizing their information and how we as an industry or we as a standalone organization also can use this data. In fact, Singapore BIM Guide has evolved from version 2 to several other detailed specifications talking about structural BIM implementation, mechanical BIM implementation, BIM for owners, everything given in detail. So this is where I continue from here with some key recommendations. It's more about what I think are some of the key points that everybody needs to be aware of, or it's more of a reminder or a best practice, whatever you want to call it. Always begin with the the end in mind. Think about what is the life cycle of this model. What information do I need to plan for right now so that the model is useful at that particular stage? And set the right expectations. It is very important because typically, at least at the management level, there is a perception to perceive BIM as a magic, where you make a 3D model, you get everything automatically, which is not the case. So setting right expectations for any implementation is important. That is where I'm showing a small graph here also. Typically for any new project, any BIM implementation exercise, expectations are much high, whereas there is a slump in productivity in the early stages, of course, because of lack of training or teams are still trying to understand the procedures and the best practices. Eventually, it goes into the next more seamless process. But by having the right expectations in place, it eases out a lot of pressure on all the team members. It makes it easy for the entire roadmap to take its own course. This is important. Be aware of this term. I'm not sure if you've all heard of this, BIM wash. It might be unintentional, but as a practice, if an employer asks for BIM experience, or if an owner says this project needs to be done in BIM, the common practice is like, okay, I'm carrying it. Let us do it. We'll sign the contract and figure it out later. So that results in a low quality outcome, where the teams are not really prepared for the amount of effort that needs to go in, or they don't have the right skill set in place, or they don't have the ability or the right credentials within the office. So be aware of it. I'm just saying this is possible. This is happening right now also. Just be aware of what you present yourself as and what others are presenting themselves as in terms of their skill set. And always learn from the previous projects. Again, I've seen within the industry at least once a project is done, okay, that is archived, we don't need to worry about it for now, thank God, let's move on to the next big thing. But there is a lot of lessons that the team has learned. And unless somebody really sits and understands and organizes that and documents and puts everything into a list of best practices, you are losing that knowledge. And if a team member leaves the company, you lost that knowledge. So document the lessons learned. This is important, purpose-built modeling. I always face this problem. Anybody who is a new modeler within a specific team, they would love to design every minute detail, including a nut and a bolt and a washer, which probably is needed only at a certain level of project or only at a certain stage or a use case. But if you're going to model every minute detail at the early stages, the models are going to be useless. And they'll be so memory intensive that you cannot even open the file properly. So define the purpose and build it for that purpose. Of course, always test and continue to improve. Test your standards and templates. There is no, okay, we have a BIM standard and a template in place. We don't need to worry about it for the next foreseeable future. That doesn't happen at all. Every project is unique. Things will improve from first project onwards. And we need to have a policy in place to take those standards and bring them back into the organization, be it the library also. Knowledge sharing sessions, I think it is already understood, unless and until we train people within our organization and we continue to improve their skill set, the project will not improve in its quality or the efficiency will not improve. So there are steps that you can take as an organization. You can have bi-weekly learning sessions. You can have latest technology trends that are being shared across all the team members, or you can assign somebody to learn new best practices that they've identified from previous projects and show to the next team members. So continue to organize the training sessions. Finally, this is very important to know. Unless and until we give high quality information, relevant and useful information into the model, we will not get the right quality and useful information out of the model. So garbage in, garbage out. We have to be very careful about what we put into these models so that we get the right output that is expected. So with that, I'd like to end my slides. I will give it back to Ms. Rashmi for Q&A.
Okay. Thank you so much, Kesri. Thank you so much for running us through the entire entire initiation of the BIM implementation process. We'll be now taking question answers. We have tons of them in our question answer inbox. But before we go through the question answer, just one small survey that we would want to run. The thing is, we plan to share such series on you with you on several topics on BIM and every other industry topics also. So there's just a survey that will pop up on your screen right now. It would be great if y'all could share with us your inputs as to what are the topics that y'all would also like to take us further on this, and what are the other things that y'all would like to hear on. Also, apart from this, there are a few other polls that would be coming up during the question answer session. These are just very specific polls to give us an understanding about the composition of our audience. This kind of helps us structure our presentations better. It kind of helps us gain knowledge into the topic and the direction we need to take for the webinars that we host. So anything that could help us profile our audience and our listeners, it would be really great. Now, there have been a lot of requests in the chat box and in the question answer saying that people would want the presentation and the slides. The presentations have a few certain confidential slides, if I'm not mistaken, which we might edit a little, and we would definitely share it with you. The entire recording of this particular session would also be on our website, which is www.commercialdesign.com. We'll be uploading it, say, like in a day, so that y'all can get a better idea. Sit through it. I know it was a bit of a heavy presentation. It was a bit on a heavier side with all the charts and the diagrams. We will definitely share them with you. This will be sent, the link of the video would be sent across to you all in the mail, which will come, I guess, tomorrow afternoon, if I'm not mistaken. Now, to probably hand it over to Kesri, he'll be taking over some of the questions that are there in the question answer box. For the audience, in the meantime, if y'all can also do the poll for us and give us the direction that we need, that would be really great. Kesri, over to you again.
Okay, thank you. So I am reading these questions here. Okay, there is one question talking about. Give me a second here, please. Okay, the first one being 4D and 5D, what type of softwares will we use? Like I said, honestly, I wouldn't convert this discussion into a software-specific discussion. I would want to keep it more as a organization-level best practices and implementation approach. Anything specific to a typical software that you would like to implement, I request the team members to contact me directly or even through ITP. I'm happy to answer those. But for the sake of this presentation, I would skip also questions about Revit. There is an interesting one. Is BIM helpful to integrate green building measures? And is it possible to achieve green building rating? Yes, of course. See, if you were to talk about green building rating, the first one that comes into my mind being LEED APU, I mean the LEED credentials. So in this case, end of the day, the way these credits are calculated is depending on the type of materials that are used, or on the type of elements that are being used in the design, or the areas allocated for a specific type of a site for that project. So in that case, BIM makes it very easy for people to calculate those areas or calculate those numbers. And it is nowadays possible to build a mathematical formula within to understand what is the final credit that comes up from. In fact, we've done an exercise many years ago about how to generate credit calculations for lead directly from a software. So there is another question, very simple, quick 4D BIM tool. There are multiple, but more interesting, another question is, what is Scan2BIM? So this technology is where you have an existing project, an age-old project, which doesn't have the as-built drawings accurately documented, or maybe the data is obsolete now. So in this case, instead of doing a traditional survey of having thousands of man-hours spent to measure and document a project, existing project, Scan2BIM will allow you to have these laser scanners, which will result in a point cloud data, which is accurate to millimeter of what is exactly present on site, and can be used for developing your accurate 3D model. There is a question about integrated means, including civil structure and finishing, or only services. See, integrated means what the project needs it to be. If the project or the scope of it, that's where the contracts and level of detail specifications matter a lot. Do I model finishes for this particular project? If that is part of the employer's requirement, that needs to be incorporated into your BIM execution plan and modeled as well. At what stage we should introduce BIM for services? At any for any project, the sooner you incorporate or start using BIM, the better it is for any project. So in this case, as soon as an architectural design layout is ready, it should be shared with all the team members at early as zoning and planning stage for services. What is the difference between LOD and LOI? LOD is a level of detail, LOI is level of information. So just to explain it a little in detail, LOD is when I model a chair with all its, I'm talking about a chair because I'm looking at one. I model a chair with all the material specifications and all the type of perforations that it has, versus LOI is what type of information I incorporate in that particular model element. The amount of, do I talk about the manufacturer, do I talk about warranty, maintenance, or do I just talk about the size? That is the difference between LOD and LOI. When can we expect first clash analysis report during detailed design? Not necessarily. I think the ideal case scenario I'm talking about is it should be clash avoidance more than clash analysis or clash detection. So the sooner you start having your team members develop your MEP models and structural models, it should be a live coordination exercise, honestly speaking. It shouldn't be restricted to a specific stage. Implementing fenestration products, external windows, etc. Yes, but which exact details, and can we also use for making BOQ? Yes, facade details, etc. are also part of a lot of BIM models. In fact, we develop very detailed facade models to generate accurate quantities. There is a question about government BIM scope of EPC turnkey projects mandated by CPWD. BIM modeling becomes just a compliance exercise. That is the major challenge. How much should the contractor be held responsible for training the employer? It's always about are you prepared to meet the employer's requirement? If yes, then agree for the scope of work, or be prepared to train your team members and Or at least have it in as part of the agreement that yes, this is contractor's responsibility to make sure they are aware of what they are getting into. But end of the day, if it is a very positive thing that employers are asking for BIM, because that in fact will push the industry in the right direction, we should take it as a good challenge to meet. So I'm from the next question. I'm from construction company. Lot of BIM consultants are available. Should we get it done from these consultants or to develop in-house team? So this is a very interesting question. In fact, I wanted to cover this in a special session as well. But just to answer your question, it very much depends on your existing skill set and the time that you have, because we are talking about a specific project with a specific deadline. And if you are trying to hire consultants just to simply make models, I would advise against it. I would suggest having an in-house team to develop your models, but hire consultants to support these teams with the right training, hire consultants to support these teams with the right standards, with the right best practices, so that the models are developed to the right quality. That I would say is the best approach than going completely outsourced or working just in-house. What about changes done during execution and after handling over to O&M? The model can be modified as per actual site condition. Yes, of course, the models are available as far as I mean, it is a software that is available. The live data is provided to all the team members. If it needs to be updated to meet the exact site conditions, that makes it a real live project.
Kesri, just one small request. We just have about, say, 2 to 3 minutes left. So maybe if you can
No,
take the
just going to say
questions quickly.
that was in fact my last question I was planning to answer today.
Okay.
Yeah, there are, I am quite happy to see a huge list of questions. I will definitely answer these through a different method.
Sure. All right. Everyone, like I said, what do you say? We would be sharing this video on our website, which is www.commercialdesign.com. The entire video and the recording of the session would be there for everyone's to view. I'm really sorry. I really see we have a ton load of questions in the Q&A. I'm pretty sure due to the time restraint, we had to leave few of them out. But we'll definitely get them answered by the speaker and share them with you all. In case of anything, please write to us. We will also be sending you all another short survey link with the email that follows up after this particular webinar. In case you all have any queries, write to us and please do fill in the form and give it to us. Thank you so much now. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you all have a good evening after this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, guys.